biggest fear I have is for routine. And I think I'm constantly battling with myself and with the people around me is not to get settled. So I'm always looking, how can we evolve as a business? How can we evolve as a team?
The last year, seeing all my colleagues pushing with no rest, you know, the wave is here, you need to grab it and do what you can with what you have.
You're always thinking, what can be done better? What's next? Of course, if you don't change anything, if you just sit down and relax on your three star, it's not going to work, but we are not like this.
I had a personality of either you do it with 100% or nothing at all. Honestly, it's probably one of the hardest things I've done, but it was a risk that I was willing to take.
I've read more books in the last year and a half. I have done more exercise, more kilometers than I have ever done. To escape into the mountains is for me the biggest form of inspiration. Basically feeling one with nature again.
You know, if you're in France, you know, the vegetable market is so peaceful, actually. You can talk to the vegetables almost. Here in Hong Kong, you cannot talk to the vegetable. You need to take it and go. Otherwise, the vendors and the other customers, they're gonna push you to move faster. Thank you.
Okay.
People have a lot of expectation. So that's why we end up creating new things and having good energy in the team.
You are working on what, you Souveg, là?
Pumpkin soup for the autumn menu.
We use only the kombucha or we have some French one also?
French one coming evening.
What I have tried is to retain these good habits because I felt I was much more productive when you are completely switched off and you have the ability to focus on something very different. It has, for me, worked as a real catalyzer for ideas. And Hong Kong gives me energy like no other city in the world.
Curiosity is a driving force in my behavior, in my daily relationship with people. I'm curious about everything, no? And food is the key to open the door of the culture.
You go, okay.
The noise, the ambience, the sense of urgency is beautiful. I love it.
Can you get me some mushroom also?
Why? When I came for the first time in Hong Kong was in 2005. I can already feel the energy. So when I got the opportunity to come to work in Four Seasons, I didn't think too long.
I've learned to know Hong Kong through Bruce Lee movies when I was 8 or 10 years old, never knowing that I would end up in Hong Kong. Hi, Jessica.
Hi.
How's it growing?
It's growing well.
What are you having for us?
The red auroch.
Always looks like amaranth.
It's got that savory flavor to it. Hard to come by in Hong Kong because they don't travel very well. Mm. This idea came about when I was working in the restaurant business. I saw a huge discrepancy between the quality of food when you try it at the source and when it gets flown in. I thought the way to deal with that was to grow produce closer to consumption.
There's nothing better than eating salad straight out of the soil.
One of the things that I love about Hong Kong market is to see ingredients that are native to my country, like jicama, chayote. In Venezuela, we call it okumo chino, beautiful root vegetable and widely used in the Asian cuisine.
When I see this product that you can find also in my country or in the countries of Latin America that I travel in, it's like a very surprising.
I'm a strong believer that Latin America and Asia is so similar, and I love it. That's why I feel like I'm at home sometimes. It's very different, but it's so similar at the same time.
And of course, your beloved.
Yeah, my sorrel, yeah. I like to make sorbet of this, you know, as a cold juice. But it's so amazing in dessert.
We're starting off pretty small. We grow about 30 to 40 different types of crops in here.
Yeah, they're beautiful. I love the pepperiness of these flowers.
We want to produce the best quality and work with some of the best chefs in Hong Kong.
Oh, mine, so, I had your last few flowers.
Well, we have a few more back there. They're your friend Ricardo's favorite. Like, he loves them.
I'm gonna tell him this. He's not gonna have any more.
So I just get the jicama. And another ingredient that I really like is the chayote. You have different varieties of chayote. This one is the most common that you can find around the world. So it's a beautiful ingredient to feature in a restaurant. It makes sense to us, and it's very special for me.
Normally it gets flowers nowadays.
This is an oca. We took the oca roots from Ricardo that he brings in from South America, and then we just kept growing it.
And I mean, you were not the farmer's daughter, so you were not farmer, so how do you know how to grow these?
It really started with a lot of YouTube videos, and then learning the principle of growing. To give it the real quality, we use organic nutrients, and what's in it is like kelp, mealworms, things like that.
Nature is perfect, huh?
We have infringed on nature for many, many years, and I think that the time has come to move forward in a bigger form of harmony.
The cuisine that we do in Mono is exactly that way to experience new things in your mouth within your comfort zone, because you are using ingredients that many people are familiar with, that we find around Asia. And Mono is exactly that. It's Asia's window to Latin American gastronomy. I used to do cuisine for other chefs that doesn't 100% belong to me. Now, being here and representing Latin America, I definitely gonna bring who I am to Hong Kong, the authentic, real Ricardo.
My specialty is French food, for sure, and you will think that you better have only French around you to provide French food, which is not true in my eyes. My number two is from India. My number three are Hong Kongese and one French.
How did we originally connect? I said that's the secret, we don't know how we connect.
Yeah, we don't even know. Somebody recommended to me back in Macau. He was with me in Macau. And I don't even remember who recommended to me. And then I call, say, can we have an interview? Then we interview, and the first interview, the connection was very quick and good.
Actually, I realized that I really need people from different countries to work with me. It helped me to create new dishes.
Well, I try a new dish. It's the first test. It's not on the menu.
By just coming here, I see 50 applications that I could have today, even within the dishes that we already have, and evolve them on what you can offer.
Every crop type in here, I had no idea what they were before. Mm. And then it's the chefs that inspire us. Hey, do you have the sorrel? No, but I'm going to go buy the seeds, and I'm going to grow it, and then you're going to tell me if it's good enough for you to buy, and what quantity. And that's literally how we build up our product catalog. This actually helps with the food wastage, the carbon footprint, and now we want to scale it to the different crop types that we're able to do.
The more I understood the statistics behind consumption and climate change, I feel that my responsibility could be to drive these awarenesses and to redefine how luxury is perceived in a restaurant.
I've been working with many French chefs. For me, Chef Guillaume is very open. Okay, for new things, not very narrow-minded.
Beautiful, this chef.
With Chef Guillaume, you have your freedom, and you can do things. You don't have to be still old school. One of the signature dish of Guillaume, crab laksa. There is a lot of Asian influence and techniques inside with the French technique.
I spent 17 years in Asia. So I'm kind of half Asian in a way. So my palate become also, in a way, half Asian.
Every chef that I know in the city, they are from all around the world. So Hong Kong offered to us a platform to express who we are. It's very competitive, the F&B industry in Hong Kong. Here where we are in Mono, we have a one Michelin star here, two Michelin star there.
So this brings you a big motivation also to be more creative and force you to be also on top of what you are doing.
You need to be always on the top, but at the same time, there is always this possibility to knock the door and ask for a favor.
How are you? How good?
Están
haciendo pruebas. Ah, te traje un regalito para Luca. Pancito, que le gusta.
And I go there, 5 minutes walking from here, and I say, hey man, can I borrow 5 pinions? Or 2 tins of caviar, and then you bring it to your restaurant and you serve it. And then they are not looking for having back, you know? That's beautiful, and that's very unique in Hong Kong.
みんな近所のシェフという感じで、はい、みんな知ってます。 デビッド・ライ、彼からはローカルのフィッシュマーケットのことだとか、ローカルの魚のことだとか、まあ、一緒にマーケットに行って教わったりだとかもしましたし、
我諗即係翻咗嚟香港，最即係你話個親切感好唔同，周圍都係人，即係一般你遇到嗰啲人咧，我諗多元化好多咯，大家嘅 background 都好唔同，咁都係一個比較適合自己嘅地方啦。
I like to hang out with Vicky from VR. We catch up quite often, you know.
You went for a hike and you got it.
Vicky is someone who's very creative.
Are you using it in your restaurant now?
Well, I use a lot.
We open a nice bottle together. We discuss about the wine.
Cheers.
So we exchange, we always talk about food together, food and wine. And the difference between our culture makes the talk.
I bring you some stuff.
Thank you. What did you bring?
You have some pâté croûte.
That was beautiful last time you gave me this. Delicious. I ate it at home. Thank you. Should we cut open?
Chef Guillaume, he's one of my closest friends in Hong Kong. We share a lot of things. We share our ups and downs. He looks after me as well, professionally, sharing his knowledge or product information.
Did you buy this in CD Super?
Well, we do ourselves, my friend.
He comes to my restaurant quite often, and I go to his. He's like a brother, and we really have a special bond together.
You have foie gras, pistachio. The base is duck, hein? And we marinated 2 to 3 days before we cook it.
Even the crust is so good.
Being a successful chef has always been my dream. I remember growing up, when all my friends were watching cartoons, I'd be watching cooking shows. I was cooking French food for many years in Toronto, in New York. At some point, I realized I wasn't learning specifically how to cook anymore. There was a natural spark in myself that I knew I was very interested in Asian flavors. And that's what led me to Hong Kong. By introducing Chinese culinary cultures into my cooking, that forced me to learn how to cook again. It was a whole new set of skills that I never knew. As it got more and more successful, that was perhaps the biggest inspiration for me to continue to merge the Chinese and the French together.
Because my husband has a lot of dreams. He is a person who will set up a 10-year goal and follow this goal.
Can I have one?
For example,
before
I got married, he told me that he would open more than one restaurant. Finally, last year, we have achieved it.
Merging the Asian flavors into my French cooking technique has absolutely been a challenge. And it's still not easy. But my ultimate goal is to open multiple restaurants. I want more people to be able to try my cuisine.
Vicky is a chef that I respect a lot for his cross-cultural message. It's very personal to him to have this Canada and Asian background, and he put it together in a beautiful way, very Western, but very local.
I always said that Hong Kong is just a little dot on the map. But this little dot has such an incredible amount of people who loves to eat. When you talk about my childhood memories, everything is about food.
Every layer of the society of Hong Kong have a different passion for food, for sure. Where did you eat last night? Where are you gonna eat next week? I make a reservation in 2 months for this place. And I strongly believe that Hong Kong, without the restaurants, it will not be Hong Kong.
I think food is continuing to evolve. I think the fine dining scene has changed dramatically, but the need and the want of having good food has never changed.
When I came to Hong Kong, I mean, all the leading restaurants 16 years ago were all pretty traditional. And I felt it was time that Hong Kong would feel something that was different. And I think it was probably the most painful journey we went through is that we were seen as a very disruptive force. We had a lot of people saying, oh, we would not expect that from the Mandarin. The way we wrote our menu, the way we would have certain combinations that were not traditional, was not what people would expect from a fine dining restaurant. So I think we've pushed the boundaries from the beginning. I think the moment that we became vanilla again and everybody loved Amber, I felt it was time again to be disruptive and to push the envelope even further.
So we have the corn, locally sourced from Hong Kong, which we're gonna cold press. So we're in constant contact with some of our farmers, but also with organic farmers in China, where we basically keep ourselves appraised on what is coming.
The most dramatic changes were really to eliminate dairy products and drive the plant-based level of our menu.
So normally in a traditional custard, you would use milk, and milk has no starch. Cold-pressed corn has a lot of starch. So we're actually reusing the natural starch within the corn. This time we're gonna make a vegetarian version with egg yolks, because the egg yolk will give it a very placid fattiness that will make it more indulgent. If we want to make the vegan version, we don't include the egg yolk.
Today we're operating above 75% plant-based and 25% animal protein. Of course, Hong Kong is a very animal protein hungry city, so that has been very complicated.
You definitely don't want to boil it, then you get scrambled eggs with corn.
Polly takes care of the PR, she takes care of the digital marketing, a lot of things that I don't really want to do because I want to spend my time and my focus in the kitchen. I want to create new dishes and also to be my biggest critic. So when I make a new dish, she's one of the first ones to ever try it. And she can kill me with it. Yeah, ma. It's
very crazy, but can we add a little refreshing element?
I feel like you need somebody honest that you can trust. And Polly's absolutely that person. Mm. In the F&B industry, it's very important that the relationship between front of house, back of house, chefs has to be connected, because you spend more time here than you do at home. Naturally, we take care of each other. And so at Veya, we have a rule that at 4 o'clock, everyone has to sit down to eat. It's not a choice, because it just doesn't make sense when you think about it that we're in the F&B business. We provide good food and good service for all of our guests, but we ourselves don't have the time to eat.
做咗父母之后，我觉得我哋两个对餐厅嘅管理啦，同埋对员工其实都改变咗好大好大。因为其实对住员工就真系好似对住自己嘅仔女咁样样，你要有时收下，有时放下，因为你唔可以永远都系硬碰硬。有时真系适当嘅时候，你要俾翻啲空间俾佢哋啦。
It's also about maintaining the balance, making sure I'm giving enough time to both families. And I feel like this is a balance that is probably most challenging to most chefs.
So we have the seawater, sudashi juice, we have the rind of the sudashi. And you know, the Chinese are very used to eat the rind of pomelo. So this actually gives the foam that we're creating more texture. Sustainability cannot be driven by one single person. It needs to be driven by a whole team of people. So we've trained our staff on what we want to achieve in a more sustainable manner.
With a classic background, you sort of become genuinely attached to cream and butter. And when you're faced with cooking in a different way, like a more pure way and away from these heavy sauces, it's a challenge, of course, for any chef. Chef Ekibus pushes us all really hard, and that's to be expected. And I think how we go about things is really the right way to do it.
So all the pulp that we use from the cold pressing, we dehydrate it, we make it into a powder, which we then melt it into this very beautiful translucent corn crisp. So you see, it is a lot of elements from very humble ingredients and make a dish that I think is quite interesting.
We got a little bit of a harsh criticism. To push sustainability was more expected from the little neighborhood restaurant than of a leading restaurant where it was about indulgence. And I think it's not the right way to see it. I think that all our food should be indulgent. I just felt it needed to be indulgent while being more responsible. And I think particularly because of the pandemic, we have to make a change.
I had one goal in my mind through COVID. I didn't want to let go of any of my staff. I knew that they were taking this paycheck to feed the family. When Veya was up and we were making money, you were there. And now, because of COVID, I need to get rid of you because now we're down. But if the money is down to zero, how can you pay them? How can I sustain the business? What should we do? Do we do takeaway? Do we open 7 days? Do we open lunch? We've never opened lunch before. Do we do that? It was one of the hardest times I've been through in terms of the level of stress, because every day I would wake up knowing that these were decisions only I can make.
As a head of the restaurant, you question yourself, I'm doing the right thing? It's so difficult, you know? But if there is something that a chef or a cook need to have, is the capacity of get out of your comfort zone. With that sense of urgency, we brainstorm with the colleagues around us and try to find a solution. The government asked us to close down the venues on the dinner time, so we could only operate to 6 in the afternoon. We didn't know 100% what to do, but I think definitely we do what is right. We keep doors open and do takeaway. It was a shock, but it was very, very fun to see people booking at 4 in the afternoon for dinner.
When the city went to sort of only serving lunchtime, all of a sudden after 6 o'clock, we were all off. And that was a great opportunity to pick up other things, to shift the focus from the negative into something very positive.
For us, we were finishing around 3 or 4 p.m. Well, we end up spending a lot of time together and developing a lot of recipe. So when you're doing that, you have time to plan the season properly. And this was also a good moment, I will say, of COVID.
The first thing we need to know is that when the people see having the restaurant closed for the dinner time, I say like, wow, there is opportunity to keep ourselves busy. So that's why it came the idea to my mind to have cacao. Why we don't do chocolate? And why it makes sense to me is because I'm coming from Venezuela. Venezuela is well known for the best cacao in the world to make the best chocolate. Since September 2020, we started the chocolate project. We fermented in the restaurant, we roasted, we grinded, and we do our own chocolate for our kitchen.
A lot of work and days of patience behind. We have a team that is very persistent. They never surrender, and cacao is not easy to make. That's why nobody else do it. But it's a high satisfaction process, and the results are amazing.
So it was that moment of happiness in the middle of closing down the doors of your restaurant in the dinner that make everybody's eyes spark a little bit.
It's beautiful. I don't know, the acidity is very nice.
So cacao in mono is a beautiful thing.
我哋頭嗰3年其實都有掙扎嘅，即係都好多時都唔滿啊，甚至好多時我哋要訂台少嘅時候，要主動打俾啲客啊，話哇好耐唔見啊，不如我哋呢排有啲咩新嘢啊，可以嚟翻嚟試試啊。
咁好彩喺疫情嚟到嘅時候，呢段時間十幾年都有好多熟客支持我哋咯。第一，其實做餐廳或者每一個 business， 其實熟客嘅支持係最緊要。除咗係一個客人嘅關係，咁都變咗朋友啦。
私自身チョコレート使うことはあってもチョコレートがどのようなプロセスを経てそのチョコレートそのものになるかというのを見たことがないし、リカルドに教えてくれと言ってリカルドのキッチンで何回かこう行っては教わったというか、そんなことをさせていただきました。I
definitely have a lot of respect for Sato-san. To mention chef that is very passionate about what is around him. When we started the chocolate project, he came to Mono to make chocolate with us.
The cacao pod, we don't want to go all the way through because we break the bean.
Okay.
So we go very slowly, very carefully. And then with the fingers, we're going to separate.
Oh.
We're going to open like that. This batch is beautiful, the aroma. Like a mangosteen.
So for the people grown up in South America, this is very common.
Depends.
Depends on
the country, yeah.
Mm.
So once we separate all the beans from the cob, so we're gonna put in the banana leaves that activate the fermentation. So actually we don't need to add any sugar. So this is the first step for the fermentation. We don't know if it's 5 days, 4 days, 3 days, because it's in the temperature of the restaurant, but we're expecting something between 3 to 5 days. This is living together with the rest.
Oh, yeah. Okay.
It's depend of the moods also, absorb the cacao.
Yeah. Uh-huh.
We might need to play some music sometimes.
Mono は旅からだいたい5分ぐらいこの近所なんで、仕込みの途中でちょっと時間を作ってリカルドのところに行って発酵のプロセスを見て、また帰ってきて翌日また行って。その一日の経過を見るという感じでやらせていただきました。
Hi, Erika. How are you?
He came every single day of the process. You see? He go to his service, you know.
It's a beautiful thing to see and to smell, actually. So we're gonna take out these beans and we're gonna dry it for the next step.
Respect to the chef, amazing. And I have a very beautiful connection because of the chocolate.
Thank you.
テクニックというのは2つがあると思うんですけど、その見ては理解できるものと、必ず何回もリピートしてやることによって習得する、むしろ練習のようなものが料理にはあるんで、それは必ず何度もリピートして身につけるようにしています。私のバックグラウンドはフランス料理とで日本料理、そして今香港に暮らしているということは、何かしらその中華、広東料理のテクニックというのを取り入れたいとオープニングからずっと思ってましたが、
まず鴨の中に、ボイルした熱湯を注いで、ミニモイスチャーを保って、かつ皮をパリッと仕上げます。
北京ダックというのは、鴨料理の中でも多分世界で一番有名な料理であって、料理人だったら作ってみたいと思うけど、多分難しいし、だからウエスタンの料理人だとか、まあ、例えば日本の料理人だとか中華以外のシェフたちは憧れはあるけど、なかなかトライできるものじゃないと。まあ私もそう思ってたんですけど、じゃあ自分がやってみようと。
When I was building this up, it was justTaking bits and pieces of what worked for other people and then thinking on what can work for myself. Every square feet counts in here. So we utilize data to help us secure consistent production and then produce better in terms of shorter period of time, higher yields, better quality, better flavors, longer shelf life for our customers.
It is exciting to see people like Jessica.Really launching this out with so much courage into actually a business that she had very little knowledge of, but is extremely passionate about, to provide incredible produce to restaurants and inspire so many chefs to put more focus on plant-based dining.
Oh, you have bok choy also.
These are ones that we're doing for Vicky. They wanted a very specific size for a dish that they're trying to do.
During the worst possible times, it's about making the best out of the situation. I had to force myself in the last 3 years to learn how to always make the right decisions. So here on the 29th floor was actually the lounge of Bayer Restaurant. We had a lot of great cocktails, a great wine list. But as the pandemic got better in Hong Kong, more and more people wanted to go out to eat fine foods because they cannot travel. And so that was natural for me to flip that into a restaurant business instead. The interest in me for Chinese cuisine has grown so dramatically that I wanted to do a fine Chinese restaurant.
疫情期間我們開了永餐廳，其實個挑戰性都真係好大㗎。到第二間餐廳嘅時候啦，咁我哋就以為啊已經係做過一次啦，即係好似已經生過一個 BB， 再生多個啫。咁點知原來個挑戰係咁大。I
had a personality of either you do it 100% or nothing at all. Honestly, it's probably one of the hardest things I've done, opening wing, but. You know, it was a risk that I was really willing to take. In a way, if pandemic hadn't happened, I'm not sure if Wing would be here today.
で、まあ、40分ぐらい経つと鴨が焼き上がります。こんな感じで綺麗な焼き色がつきます。そしたら今度ここから水を抜きます。
北京ダックを作っていく中でモチベーションをキープする、維持するというのは本当に難しいことではあるんですが、一回一回のチャレンジの後にいつも疑問だとか、なぜこうなんだろうとか、次はこうしてみたらいいんじゃないかというのが常に出てくるんで、それが次へのモチベーションになってますね。
まあ、今回の鴨はちょっと油が少ないんで、少しリーンな味で、ただフレーバーはすごくあるし、結構乾いた感じのクリスピーになって
た。私が北京ダックを始めた時から今まで基本的には誰も作り方を教えてくれてないんですよ。で、例えば人に教わってしまうと何かを学ぶ機会を逆に失ってしまうこともある。で、自分でやってみると失敗したらまたやり直すとか調整するとか、逆にプロセスを楽しんでる。まあ、自分が突き詰めて自分が納得したものをお客さんに出して、でお客さんがそこにすごく喜んでいただけると、そういった形でコミュニケーションを取ってるんだと思います。
We had a very regular French guest that said he was dreading to come to Amber because he didn't like the new direction, and he asked me to come to the table at the end of dinner and apologized for his misperception of the restaurants. For him, the perception that we were cutting out butter and cream, that we were cutting out indulgence. And we have actually shown that there's many plant-based alternatives. And even if people are unhappy or do not enjoy something, we need to find a way to make them happy, because seeing everyday people leave the restaurant being happy and content and coming back, that's the only measurement for me for success.
即係我哋嘅主要工作咧，係每日令到好多人開心啊！咁啲人嚟，佢肚餓，咁我哋俾嘢佢食。咁誒，佢哋想食乜嘢，我哋嘗試俾啲更好嘅嘢佢食。咁誒係一個比較單純啲嘅 arrangement。呢一方面我諗即係自己係完全可以一路做落去。
Even before the restaurant opened, I knew that my guests were already thinking, okay, what kind of Chinese restaurant would a French-trained chef open? So there are specific dishes in Chinese restaurants you cannot get rid of. Like steamed fish, chicken, rice, dishes that you really need to have. Now, opening Wing, I needed to put a steamed fish on the menu. But I knew that my steamed fish had to be different. I knew that I had to respect this taste, but make it my own way.
Bon, what are we eating today, brother?
We're doing this fish. We're gonna make it a little bit more crispy.
Why?
Just by ladling oil on top.
And so in this particular dish, we added a layer of crispiness from the scales. But the flavor of it is very traditional, slightly sweet soy sauce with the same scallion, coriander, and the hot oil.
Usually, what do you serve with this kind of fish? White wine?
You do champagne, we do white wine.
Perfect. And how is the business?
Business is good,
yeah?
Very good.
Bookings is already all the way up until March. Just like yourself, we bounce back quite strong. And you?
We have booking problem. A lot of people want to come, so it's a good problem to have, I would say.
Yeah. It's awesome.
Yeah, super.
We'll plate it up and we should have it together. Cool. Let's go.
Ali.
And you're going to wear me these two too, okay? Then we're going to slightly top some almond for our mole sauce. Mole is a sauce that is typical from the Mexican cuisine. A lot of ingredients involved in that. You have 21 ingredients. So first of all, how to put flavors that doesn't match together, but make them match. So we're gonna add the spices. Immediately you see a little bit of smoke coming out. That's the perfect temperature. We don't want to burn them. We want just to toast very quick. In Asia, we're bringing a sauce that is very unknown in this part of the world, but it's very similar with ingredients and with profile of flavor that we have in this side of the world. So we're gonna add now the paste of peppers that we buy in the local market. We have bell peppers, Korean peppers. We have ñora paste from Spain, pimón de espelette from France, chile ancho from Mexico. I want to start saying that Hong Kong is a mole. Okay? Why I say that? Because we have a lot of things that make one strong community, formed by many kind of other cultures.
If me and you were to open a restaurant, what do you think? For sure, it would be something more casual.
There's many concepts that can come out with my knowledge on European product, your knowledge and vision on European and Asian product. Can be plenty. Can be from noodles to
laksa.
Laksa.
You have a laksa dish in
your place. Yeah, absolutely.
When do we open? The crispy tao fish is a dish that can truly represent my Chinese cuisine. This is everything that's classically steamed fish flavor, but only we add additional crispiness to it.
Let's try. This fish is very delicate. Scales crunchy.
Mm-hmm.
The sauce is super good. You have a very good richness. You don't see that kind of sauce in a Cantonese restaurant.
As you know, sauce making is a big part of French cuisine.
Oui.
So instead of putting an ordinary soy sauce, you take it to the next level by adding umami flavor, by adding essence to make a nice balance of the crispiness of the fish.
I love coriander.
Yeah.
Especially with steamed fish, it's superb.
When you combine coriander, scallion, and ginger together, that is my idea of the flavor of Hong Kong.
Very Cantonese.
Yeah.
I love it.
Growing up as a French chef and opening a Chinese restaurant is very difficult for me to compete with the master chefs here in Hong Kong,
yep,
who's been cooking for 20, 30, 40 years.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm sure I don't have the knowledge as great as them.
You have different knowledge.
So one of the goals in Wing is to create dishes that our guests can't immediately compare with other restaurants. And so we have a lot of dishes that perhaps you can only have here. And this fish is absolutely one of them.
Cheers, thank you.
Cheers.
Brilliant.
Thank you.
Beautiful fish.
It's a paste that we do with burnt eggplant. We add some nuts inside. We have active charcoal to make it a little bit darker. And we add chocolate as well. can immediately see that the paces start to be a little more smooth, but you always want to keep a little bit of rusticity too, no? The lime zest is the cherry on the cake. They give you the freshness and put all the ingredients together. Wow, super nice. The texture have a taste of South America. That roughness, that, but at the same time, very sexy, no? And then we have the chayote as well that we buy in the market. You grow up in Hong Kong, you always have it with your grandma, with your mom, in soup, in the restaurant, but you never had in that way. So it's like music. You have melodies that you might think that you hear before, but it's in a new way to hear it, in a new song. We are well known for being happy in South America. We're always dancing, smiling, and having fun. We're passionate about what we do. And at the end of the day, that's what we are here for, is to make people forget about their problems and make them live a beautiful experience at the same time.
You know, a chef that is happy, you can feel it in the plate. And food always brings people together, no matter where you're from, no matter who you are.
We adapt a lot. We learn that together we can do better things and be stronger. And it's thanks to Hong Kong that I meet myself, my real self again.
For me, the fighting spirit of Hong Kong is its resilience.
It's the resilience of the Hong Kong people, of wanting to reinvent themselves constantly and rebounding within any moment of challenge. And if you see how well the restaurants are thriving in Hong Kong, I'm extremely optimistic.
They have this phrase in Hong Kong called Phuk Tay, which literally means it's a land that's invincible. I don't think the fire in Hong Kong would ever be out.